Just on organiser, is there any thoughts on what we missed out about the organising? Are we all happy with that particular role, which is more to do with practical stuff? Steve?
I didn't know there was such a thing as an organiser. I know I'm very naive, but I've just realised that actually it's obvious that people are driving force. Who actually is the organiser of the crowd group?
I tend to take over the organising.
So I organise. Didn't even know you were.
Well, I organise. Well, you know the schedule post that comes up and it's kept up to date. Well, I do that.
So maybe organisers need to let people know they're organisers.
Possibly, yeah. Possibly.
Take you for granted, I think.
Take it for granted. Yeah, it's a good idea. Phil is the treasurer there. Phil takes the donations. It was. They were called subscriptions. Yeah. They're not subscriptions. If you haven't got any money, you don't give. If you're a bit skint. The donations, and it works well. Benevolent people that are members of PIPs give, you know. But this is what happens on Merseyside. I don't know about the rest of the country. So it helps to pay for things like this, those donations.
And so a member is what? You didn't define a member. What's a member?
Sorry?
What is a member? Somebody
who gives? Somebody who comes to PIPs.
You don't know what constitutes a member. Isn't someone who pays dues, because the man owns dues. Arthur said it's someone who attends.
Yeah.
Or if you look at me, you're a member. But we don't know, we call them member subscriber, but then it's been argued that they're not subscribers because they're not given any subscription. So maybe we shouldn't use that term. It's not clear.
Voluntary donations.
That's what they are.
Seems to be a good
thing. So MI5 people attend and they're members.
Okay, any more questions on the organisation side of it, running the PIPs? What about the facilitation?
I have a comment on it, a question. Within the group, or within groups I've been to, we always encourage people to facilitate. I have a concern that some people, there are people who attend that perhaps don't have as much commitment or investment in PIPs as others, so they are not aware of how they should facilitate. What way can we go about, and this has been a brilliant day today for facilitation training, but what way can we go about encouraging people within our group? Should we give some thought to if some can facilitate and some shouldn't until they've been for a while?
It is an interesting question, that one. It connects to membership. You know, what is a member? What we have, we tend to have some people are supporters that actually do stuff. Other people are spectators and they just want to come in and get off, and that's okay. It is that kind of a loose association. But obviously, we're looking for people with a bit more commitment and want to do a little bit, so that, you know, because we believe it's a good cause and what we do, you know.
Well, I think what came up in our group was how, I don't know whether the word's complicated, but how in-depth being a facilitator is. And, you know, we realised how you had to sort of take in the whole group and you had to be the eyes and ears right round the group. And, you know, that you couldn't possibly get involved with the conversation because you were too involved with who needed to speak next and who said what and how to summarise it, how to bring it down. And basically, I think what I've come away with is, even if you're not facilitating, that we should support the facilitator. And Arthur came up with a thing whereby he said, you know, when people are putting their hands up and their names and whatever, and we do write a list in the group, in the crown, don't we? But perhaps we should split that role in as much as somebody is facilitating, but somebody's actually working the group, looking round, seeing who wants to, you know, put the talk next, and actually do that list. So while it's only a minor role, it's still supportive. And then looking at splitting it so that being a facilitator isn't as daunting as it is now for some people.
I thought of this before I came today. And you know, when we first started off, when we were in the brewery, I'm sure that we used to have a paper that spoke of the duties of the observer. We used to have a facilitator for taking names, but we also used to have an observer for observing what was going on and doing what you do really well, Paul, and I'll ask you about that sometime because I'm not good at it, i.e. Looking at where we are with the discussion, what's being said, and keeping check on and coming back to it and whatever. Well, can you remember that we used to...
We used to have a summariser.
Summariser.
This is where we've got to.
Yeah, and I think that's what Mal's suggesting now, that we, you know, maybe there's a need for two people, one to observe well and summarise, and one to keep check of the names.
Especially with a big group, because you know, the crowd now is becoming 20 plus, isn't it? Some weeks.
Okay.
Do we throw some of them out? You're not looking at me, are you?
Can I say that if I can draw an analogy with a walking group, we always have the problem of having individual walk leaders, and it's quite a responsible position. And one of the things that is really good for the group is for everyone to have a turn at being a walk leader, because what it does is engender a sympathy, empathy, whatever you want to call it, with the walk leader, which helps for the discipline of the group. And the other thing I would say is that in the end, people who are organisers are likely to be people who've been through the facilitator route. I mean, certainly Arthur would come into that category, and therefore they act as the sort of the backup, both generally, and if you've got a new walk leader, a new facilitator, the value of having an elder statesman there is very great for the evolution the role.
Yeah, the idea of who's facilitating the group came up in our inquiry group just then, and Russell mentioned it, about how many people and do we need a facility when it's only five. And I got talked about, and then I said that what we want is that everyone's facilitating in a way, facilitate themselves.
I've always had the impression when I've attended any PIPS group is that facilitating was not like a duty, more like a privilege. So it's very difficult for people to put themselves forward because they think they're being they're stepping out of line.
I don't get that.
Well, I mean, people think that it's a privilege to be that, and they're scared of putting themselves forward.
Well, exactly.
But that is the impression most people have. You know, they think, I'm not good enough, and I'm scared of doing it, and it's my duty to do it.
Okay, well, let's see what people think that, are there?
I for once agree with David Cameron, who said that we should spread the privilege.
Is it privileged?
I don't mean to be personal, and stop me if one goes on that. But I tend to think that is your attitude, Derek, and could be the attitude of others as well. You know, that you sort of think rank and think hierarchy. And that's not what PIPS is about. You know, so if you've got ideas like that, maybe they need to be squashed.
It's not up to me to squash them. I can't squash them myself.
I just mean yourself.
I know people who think that you have to be gone there for a while and get well integrated, etc., before you're allowed to be.
It's not about being allowed, it's about realizing
maybe that's something that we need to make clear then to PIPS members. If some people are thinking that way, the egalitarian aspects of PIPS needs stressing, maybe at the groups.
That's right, it connects to commitment, that doesn't it? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, what else you feel?
Well, especially for new people, that they should feel.
Hang on.
I was just going to, I'll forego my comment because it's been dealt with, thank you.
Sometimes I kid people at the Rose and Crown to let them have a go. And maybe what we should do is plan it properly. Mm. So the one week I'll say, I'm not going to do it next time, who's going to do it? Mm. And really to say, I'm not doing it next week. Somebody is going to have to do it, you know, so the people will have a go.
Yeah.
And, the, you know, it's a bit of encouragement, but also, you know, determination.
Yeah, you're right. I'm guilty of not doing that. I just fall into it.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know so much. You've done it a few times where you've said...
You've asked people to
I think, you know, does anybody want to facilitate? But I'd still go back to the shared responsibility. I still think, you know, the facilitator should have the sidekick.
Okay. Maureen?
I do think it's a good idea that Mal said that you should have somebody taking names and be a facilitator. I've tried to facilitate myself and found it really difficult. I don't think that... I think most people don't want to be facilitators because they want to join in, and it's very, very hard being a facilitator. I think most people realise that, but they don't realise to the extent unless you actually do it. And I don't think that they think that, you know, it's like Derek thought, that, you know, I don't think most people think that, not the people I, because I go to lots of groups and I've spoken to them, but I do think that there is a problem. I know Arthur was saying that somebody will have to do it, but often you'll find that people just won't do it, so then somebody who can do it is forced to do it, and I think that's just the nature of PIPs. I don't know how you're going to change that, because you can't really force somebody to be a facilitator the same as you can't force someone to change their opinion. And I think
no, I'm not doing it. It's exactly it, seems to me.
Yeah, but then...
Coming quickly on that.
It'll just be a bit chaotic, and it?
Yeah, but you'd only do it when you thought the group was ready for it.
But then I just know from my experience of groups that most people don't want to do, and the reason why is because they want to take part, because you can't... It'd be very difficult to take part, because you just... But it's much... It might be easier with taking the names, because I do agree with that, that looking around for the names and trying to facilitate is far too much, I think.
Thank you. Alan?
Do you say at the beginning who wants to be the facilitator? That's the point, you see. That if you say that, if it's a large group, probably most people would think no. Because, and there again, coming back to Derek's point, does the person who says, yes, I will be, did they feel that, oh, I'm being a bit egotistical here? Am I, you know, what will other people think, sort of thing? There is a problem there. So do you throw the name into a hat? Do you know, do you have to throw a dice or something? Or
that's a good idea. You could put everyone who feels like doing it in the future, put the name into a hat.
Exactly.
Well, we could do that.
It wouldn't be a bad idea, would it?
Most people don't want to
promote people to do it, because it's affecting ourselves, changing ourselves. Once you've done it, it makes you a better discusser, better inquirer. Mm-hmm. Veronica?
Oh, Victoria.
It's Victoria, sorry.
That's all right. Yeah.
I like
that's okay. A couple of things. I'm with Mal on this idea of shared responsibility, not just a specified role, but the group itself has to have a robustness about it, and it has to feel that it's got ownership of the debate. And what came up at our discussion was that there wasn't a product, that only the facilitator knew what the outcome was going to be. We were part of a process. And so it's our involvement in that process and supporting the facilitator in whatever way is important. And I've had really brilliant people who just said, you've missed so-and-so. And they've not said, oh, you've just forgotten Peter! They've just, you know, they've helped you. So rather than accusing you and offering that sort of... But the other thing is, I think, that it is a complex thing. And you can join in if you... want to move the debate on, because the ultimate object is to get the very best discussion that you can, and that people have the chance to contribute in sequence sometimes, but not always. And so sometimes somebody needs to add something to a train of thought, and they need to come in before somebody else. So you have to apologise and say, I'm sorry, you know, I'm going to let so-and-so in just to continue. So it is a skill, and it comes from practice. And the more practice people have, the better it becomes, and if the atmosphere is encouraging, then that works. If it's combative and competitive, then it doesn't.
Thanks, Victoria.
Me? Yes. No, yeah. I was just thinking, following that point, that if you are a facilitator, actually you're in the best possible position to make a contribution, because you can pause things and say, at this stage, I'd just like to say a couple of things. So actually, you're in a very good position. But I guess your contributions have to be extremely pertinent. and justified in the space of facilitator. But I think you've got the opportunity, because you're a facilitator, and you can at certain times just stop and say something. So I think it actually gives you a bit of...
That's the discipline of it, though.
It is. Oh, yes, I understand that.
If it moves it on.
I just wanted to make a point very similar to Maureen's. Most of the people that go to the groups I go to... Sorry, you did say Dulcie, didn't you?
I did, yeah.
Most of the people that go to the groups I go to don't want to facilitate, and simply they like the convenience. And I'm not knocking them, we need them there. Yeah. But they like the convenience of coming and having somewhere to discuss an issue, weekly or monthly or whatever it is, but maybe they don't. They are unable to commit to anything more, I don't know. But we need more of this kind of thing, or to build in something where we always let people know how, well, not how difficult, because that will put people off, but how we need to support facilitators. Because for me, and this is my own experience, and please argue with me if you wish, it's for me, it's the people who aren't committed and don't read about PIPs and don't take on board what PIPs are trying to do. Those are mainly the people that interrupt the discussions and don't want to facilitate.
Okay, we've got 2 minutes left, and we've got Steve and Phil.
I know that Jubin is very good at facilitating, and I'm so impressed by that. And I realise some people really are good at it, inherently. And some of them would be really bad, like me, because I get totally lost in ideas, right? So I need to be managed. And they're both useful people. I mean, there's different types. So one side of me says, yes, we need to encourage good facilitation, and you only get that by practice. And maybe some of us don't even know we're any good till we do it. On the other hand, we need to honor the fact that some of us are not good at doing it. And so, I mean, just throwing that out. Just come on.
And the last concise word goes to Phil.
Yes, I'd say having two people doing those two tasks of facilitating and the summarizing could be very, very useful. And to actually have a defined time when the summarizer will do their task, such as when everyone comes back from the break, you know. So the summarizer would be disciplined into paying attention and producing a coherent sort of structure about what has been happening. And then they, very briefly, 1 or 2 minutes, try and summarize those without mentioning people. Yes. So, you know, this is what we've been talking about, blah, blah, blah. You know, can we now continue on with this?
Okay.
So so having those two people, and they'd have to be volunteers and sort of accepted at the very start at the beginning of the meeting. So those two roles could be very productive.
Right. Wouldn't we need more than one summarizer? Because when we split up into groups, we'd need more than one summarizer, wouldn't we?
If you did it, that test, I think we're just talking about the main inquiry, not the group stage. The group stage are doing other things, aren't they?
Yeah.
Problematising and coming up with a question.
Mm-hmm.
And there's only a few of them, so.
So the summariser would just be at one table?
Just be in the main inquiry when they come back.
But where would the summariser be when we've split up into two groups?
Yeah, that's a good point, yeah.
No, I agree with you. You'd need one per group, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
But the groups report back to the main group, don't they, when they come back to the plenary?
But where will that one summariser be when we split into two groups?
In one of the groups.
So there's probably a bit of bias there.
Enjoying themselves for 5 minutes.
Yeah. What Dave raised here is a good point, because when we just have the main inquiry, we don't split into groups. Mm. That's when it would come in. But when you split up into groups, it would be less need for it. So it's a good point. Okay, we're done now. Got to go. Thanks for coming. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.